everybody to our webinar this month. So we are going to be talking about stores, talking about shops and repair businesses. So let me go ahead and introduce our panel to everybody. Welcome everybody who's watching live. And of course, we're recording this. It'll be posted on YouTube later. So first up on our panel, we have Javier Guzman, who owns and operates Mr. Phone Doctor in Las Truchas in New Mexico. I probably said that wrong.
That's not good.
And he also has an awesome YouTube channel. If you haven't plugged into his YouTube channel, you should. He's got a lot of great tips and information on there. Say hi to everybody, Javi.
Hey, what's up, guys? Good meeting you all.
All right. Thanks for being here. Next up is Jonathon Slyman. He owns iTech Sharks in Baldwin, Missouri. But he also operates buyback.ai, which is a really cool buyback platform that they're developing and have some folks in now. And it'll be rolling out in the near future. So hey, say hey to everybody, Jonathon.
Hey, everybody. Nice to meet you.
Thanks for being here, Jonathon.
No problem.
Then Scott Randolph. Scott owns and operates Skinny's Repair Shop. Has three locations in Texas. You see the cities there. And they're really cool. I love the design, Scott. So say hi to everybody.
Hey, thanks. Appreciate having me on. And yeah, thanks for the compliment, man.
So thanks for being here today, Scott. Joseph on here, who owns Cell Medic in Port St. Lucie and Vero Beach, Florida. And also has a mobile repair operation as well. Say hi to everybody, Joseph.
Hey, guys.
All right. And Juan, last but not least, is also on the call today. Juan is the owner-operator of One-Click Repairs. And he's a straight-up, I don't think you have a store, Juan, is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, we had an office, but we just switched completely to mobile during COVID.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, I love your setup, too. I was pretty impressed when you showed, you know, your little mobile setup that you have. I think leaning off the back seat. We'll see a picture of that later, though, for everybody. But welcome.
Yeah, we actually changed it up today, so you folks will see what we got new now.
Ah, okay, cool. I'm looking forward to that. That's awesome. Just real quick, we're going to be doing some prize drawings later in the webinar. So for those that are actually attending, again, this is mainly a recording that will go out on YouTube later. But, you know, today we're going to be giving away a resistor level membership to the Tech Care Association, which is worth $250. Some free t-shirts, and then also a $100 Visa gift card for y'all that are attending. And you can see that's one of our new t-shirts that we just got in. I wore that into an Apple store when I was in Vegas, and for some reason they weren't that excited about it. I don't know why. So
Rob, I'm going to need a link for that.
Yeah, we got the site for sale. So check out techcareassociation.org under our merch, our new merch column. So it's our first piece of merch. We're looking forward to adding a few things. So, and then a bonus, if you join today, you can also win a free membership upgrade to the next level on any of our paid memberships. Also, if you join the association today, you're going to get a free t-shirt. And then also we'll do a drawing for anybody that joins today. So next like 24 hours, it doesn't include you guys watching on YouTube later. Sorry. But we'll give away a $100 Visa gift card to somebody there that joins. So we got a lot going on there, and let's hit on our topic. So we're going to do a little bit different this webinar. Last few webinars, we had kind of some segments that we covered, but we're just going to go through shops and check out shops overall. We'll see some pictures, a couple of videos that we have from these guys that I hope everybody really enjoys. So, you know, again, welcome to our webinar. And also when, you know, people are looking at your store, the first thing they're going to get is the outside of your store and the welcome to your store, basically. So here's three shops out there that I thought had a pretty good layout that are very welcoming. You guys know that, you know, going to a repair shop can be a little bit intimidating for people. They don't know a lot about it. We're working really hard on raising awareness for the industry. But one way you can help yourself is to have a nice clean storefront, okay? So good, clean logo, good, clean, you know, look on the outside. And yeah, that includes cleaning the windows and making sure it's not too cluttered. Some of these guys I know have used street signs and things like that, or have a vehicle parked out front. That's a good way too to attract business. But here are three different shops that you can kind of look at and get an idea of having kind of a warm welcome is what I call it. So you want it to be welcoming and make people feel comfortable coming into a store. Any you guys want to comment on the idea of, you know, the outside and what it means to bring into a store?
I would definitely say I can agree with that. Something I've learned is even in the small town we're in, we've put out a few repair shops out of business just by the simple unfortunate fact that when you look at the outside of their business, it looks like you're going into a vape shop or a smoke shop. And that's honestly, there's even in a couple of pictures that you have listed here, it looks welcoming, but there's definitely still concerns that I can see that I would address in these stores.
Sure.
But I can definitely agree with that. You definitely want that welcoming, get them in the door and make them feel that they're walking into an actual caring retail environment versus someone that's just trying to sell or something that just looks like you kind of threw it together in 10 seconds.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey, Scott, you know, I saw in one of your shots a signboard, you know, and you guys do the chalk. Do you still do that? Tell us about that.
Yeah, we do that. And on those, actually, you know, we've kind of, we hire just like a local artist to do them. Nice. She kind of does it upright. You know, we try to go pretty simple. I'm not using it right now, but yeah, that's always an easy way. And we just kind of make it, you know, clean, inviting. We're right on our downtown square, so we get a lot of foot traffic. Nice. So that's always been just an easy way to just get people wondering like what we do. And I mean, you can even list like, you know, clean out your charge board for free or something, you know, just to get people in the door.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I like that. That's a really good idea. Any of the other guys have something unique to do outside the store?
Well, I'm exclusively mobile.
Yeah.
But besides being mobile, I also do pop-up shops every weekend.
Oh, cool.
At local farmers markets and colleges.
Nice. Nice. Do you have a lot of signage or are you just kind of something small that you use? What do you do?
I mean, I have like my table set up. I usually bring down all my stuff so everyone can see all my screens and all that. And I'll have a few just signs around that just kind of explain what we do, have the barcode so they give you our pricing if they want to just book an appointment for another day or even to leave us our Yelp review, our Google review, and also, you know, what helps besides my car having my signage all over is wearing a uniform because, you know, your store or wherever your setup can look good. But if you're not representing yourself right, then customers aren't going to feel good.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. And I think, you know, overall look for the outside and some of the comments you guys made is that professional look, right? So, you know, show them that you're a professional operation. You're not, you know, where I am in Washington, D.C., we actually have some repair shops that are even in laundromats. Just because, you know, retail space is so expensive. I used to own stores, believe me, I know how expensive it is. But yeah, just not really, you know, you want to have a professional look. So shirts, you know, things that are warm and welcoming, like the chalkboard that Scott's using, you know, the signage, the outside look of your store, and keeping it clean too. Again, wash those windows. Fingerprints just look sloppy. So, okay, well, let's move on and take a look at the front desk, okay? So, and you know, this is not anybody on this call's shop yet. They're all like saying, where's my shop? We're going to show that to the patients because these guys all have some nice shops that I want to show off later. But, you know, the front desk or the front counter, you know, just to give you an example, we used to spend, it was about $3,000 to $5,000 on just the front counter in my store. So we had them custom made and they were really impressive and big and easy to do business over. But you see a few examples here of that. I know, you know, again, you guys use certain ways to check in people, but, you know, what do you think? Like, Javi, tell me about your check-in process when you have a customer come in.
You know, check-in process is pretty simple. You know, we like to, of course, see what issues the customer's having. And then, you know, we do like a full inspection of the device with the checklist that we built on a repair shopper. So, you know, it's pretty straightforward. We just want to be transparent with the customers and let them know, say, hey, you know what, we do need to get your codes and all this stuff because we want to make sure we give you the device in the same way that we checked it in. So, it's basically just pretty much covering our ass and giving a customer a good expectation of what's going to be done. And, you know, if we see anything else wrong before the repair, we let them know. And of course, you know, we let them say, hey, you want to do the battery or your front camera as well, because we see that that's not functioning properly.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. I like that. And Jonathon, you guys have, we're not going to, I don't want to do the reveal on the really cool thing you got yet. I'm going to do that when we
stop.
And trust me, he's got something really cool at his shop. You're going to see it in just a few minutes. So you want to hang on for that. But But in terms of store check-in and front counter, Jonathon, what does it look like at iTech Chart?
Yeah, so we've got you know your basic counters. We try to get the customer checked in super quick. So we really don't. We only ask the necessary questions. We don't want them hanging around. We just want to get them in and out as soon as possible.
Yeah, very cool. So, you know, just if you look at these photos there that we have up on the screen there, I mean, they're very clean, very, you know, pronounced front counters. You know, CPR does very, you know, corporate, you know, look. A lot of their stores look alike, which, you know, that can be good in some ways. But if you'll notice something else too, they've got stuff for sale around them, right? So, you know, the CPR counter's got a spindle on it. The shop in the middle has a display case in the counter, which is really kind of cool. It's got some phones and things in there. And then the FixPal one, which I think is a Canadian company, has some accessories behind the counter, and then also that plant. You know, it's kind of warm. It's kind of welcoming. So that front desk can be really important and important when customers come into your shop, to make sure they know where to go. So you definitely want to spend a little on that. The waiting area that is kind of controversial, I've found, for some people. Some shops do not have waiting areas. I mean, sometimes it's a size thing. Obviously, you know, with what Juan's doing with mobile repair, he doesn't have, you know, he can't, I don't know. Do people sit like in your car while you're doing a repair, Juan? You ever had
that? No. No, I mean, I do have a chair. If they want, I'll pull it out. But for the most part, you know, I'm going to these people's houses. Yeah, I do my repair for my vehicle, obviously, in businesses. I just pick it up, bring it back when it's done.
Right. Yeah. I it would be kind of funny if somebody said, hey, can I sit in your car? So, you know, let's talk about that for a minute. And Joseph, I'll hit you first since we haven't heard from you in a little while. You know, what do you think about the waiting area in a store? I mean, do you guys do it or what do you do?
We have a very small waiting area. It's just two chairs. Kind of like the ones in the quick mobile repair picture. We have a larger style table in the middle of our shop that we use for customer interactions. But as far as waiting, what I've come to learn is with the way our shop is set up, we want those customers kind of walking around and putting their hands on accessories, looking at devices, stuff like that. So we try to make them not too comfortable as far as the waiting goes, but you always get that customer that you kind of need to accommodate. They have some sort of medical issue or what may be it. So of course you want them to be comfortable, but at the same time, we kind of want people up and moving and looking at accessories, at devices, stuff like that.
Yeah. I get that. And you know, let me just say too, the waiting area is really, you know, for every business, you know, what you do with that. It's a simple waiting area. Or something, you know, larger and more comfortable. You know, I found that I had a dozen stores here in the DC area, and we found each of our waiting areas was different, quite honestly, depending on where it was located. One of our waiting areas actually was really popular. It was a more suburban location. And so we put a little child's play area in it. Some of the working moms or stay-at-home moms would come by, you know, with their kids. Weekends, the dad who were hanging out with the kids and have a little play area for the kids. Found that to be valuable there, but we tried it in another location that was more urban, more business district, and it didn't work. It was not needed. So yeah, every spot's different. Hey, Scott, what do you guys do? I haven't seen that in your shop. Do you have a waiting area or what do you do?
Yeah, we don't. We've gone back and forth. When I first opened our storefront, we did. And it's kind of bittersweet, you know, you want the customers to be comfortable, but you invite a lot of just kind of hanging out, asking about how the repair is going, asking, you know, if we've got it ready. You just get a lot of questions that you don't really want during repair. You want to just kind of, at least for me, I want to be relaxed. You know, we tell them what time frame it is and they take off. What's cool at our Waco location, we're right next door to a coffee shop and bar. So a lot of times we can just tell them, hey, go grab a beer, go grab a coffee, hang out. About 30 minutes to an hour, you know, you'll be good to go. And that's been really big for us. Here in Stephenville, since we're on the square, people can walk. There's a big restaurant across the road. And the same thing, like the guy said earlier, you know, it kind of encourages people to walk around, look at accessories, see things they wouldn't see if they were sitting down staring at a wall for 30 minutes or so. So yeah, we don't really offer them. We've got chairs we can bring down for like elderly people, people with injuries, whatever they need to do, but.
Nice. Cool. And I mean, you know, it's different strokes for different folks. I get the idea. We'll talk about actually talking during repairs and stuff here in just a second with another design concept. Jonathon, I couldn't remember if you guys had a waiting area. I don't think you did you?
We have a small waiting area just along the wall, just similar to the quick mobile repair. We've been back and forth as well. We've had several stores without any waiting area, and then also some with some. We used to have stores in grocery stores, and we got a lot of people just hanging out, not necessarily, just asking random questions. We had some PCs, gaming PCs. We had customers just hanging out all day long. So we kind of got rid of the waiting area and just reduced it to a few chairs.
Yeah, I get that. I totally get that. Cool. Well, let's move into the next section then. And this is what I was talking about. Open repair in terms of having your technicians available out there in front. And you can see that in this is actually a little different CPR location, which I like the design overall. I'm somebody who's not convinced on open repair, though. I know a couple of you guys do it. I would assume Juan with the mobile repairs, you might be able to close yourself off, just shut the roll up the windows, right? But what do you guys think about the idea of having an open repair area where customers can interact while the repairs are going on, or having a closed area? And I'm guessing you're going to be one or the other on each one of those. So I want to hit each of you guys, and I'm actually going to start with Juan. He's at the bottom of my screen. So Juan, how do you deal with that? Do you have customers that want to hang out while you're doing repairs when you're doing them in your car?
I used to have it. The photo that you folks probably saw before was on the side. Now my vehicle setup is a little different, so I could actually open my trunk and everyone would be able to see. I personally don't mind. Some people want to stay. For me, I use it. It's more of a way for me to upsell because they're watching. So if I do a checklist through my phone, so they go, that's how they read everything. And through the checklist, that's how I ask them questions about their battery. I check out the whole device. So while I'm doing it, I have my Protection Pro out. So immediately, if they already said no, it's my chance to kind of speak to them doing it. If I open up their phone and their battery's dead, it's like, oh, right now I could easily just pop it out. So I kind of use it as my opportunity to kind of upsell.
Yeah, that's a cool idea. I hadn't really even thought of it that way. Scott, what about you guys? I think you do repairs on the floor, yeah, in your stores?
So we have both. So I've got our Stephenville store we have a designated front area with a back room. And then Waco, we're completely open. And honestly, I think I like closed more just because, at least for me, there's just, I don't know, it's just nice to have that space. And Waco is kind of nice having it open. I think we've got like 7 or 8 competitors there, and they're all, I don't know, there's a few, they're not all, there's a few that, you know, are kind of questionable. Like we talked about how they look like kind of like a vape shop or something. And so people already have like a weird idea that they're sketchy and they take your phone to the back and who knows what, you know? So in Waco, we decided to just leave it open. Want people to see what we're doing. And that's really gone over really well there. And it helps that we don't have, you know, seating. So that way people drop off, they leave. So honestly, I like both. I think I would like close off a little bit better just because privacy wise, it's just nice to be able to, you know, not have a customer. For me as an owner, they always kind of want to come see me so I can kind of hide in the back and they can deal with somebody else. So honestly, there's pros and cons of both. And we do both.
I get it. Jonathon has a really cool solution, I think, which actually the picture on the right-hand side of your screen is his back room, but it doesn't show the important part. Jonathon, tell everybody about that.
Yeah, so we've experimented with both in the past. Our smaller stores we had open, and our larger stores we had all closed off. We kind of liked the both best worlds. So what we did at this new larger location was we put in a soundproof glass wall that separates the showroom from the repair room. So customers can still see what's going on, but our employees aren't distracted. They can't hear a thing that's going on in the showroom. And it's, kind of the best of both worlds. We also have an area that is completely closed off. So if a technician chooses that they don't want to be looked at, they can always go repair the device in the other room.
Cool. Cool. Yeah, I love that. And it is literally a soundproof wall. Is that correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
I love it. So that kind of gives you the best of both worlds in a way. Customers can, you know, be assured that somebody's not in the back, doing something weird. and that, you know, you can have that privacy. So I like that. And I like the idea that you allow your technicians a private area too, because I know some guys are really self-conscious about that. So that's awesome.
Yeah.
So Joseph, tell me about what you guys do.
We're completely closed repair.
Okay.
We don't play the open concept. I've come to learn that with the open concept, unfortunately, you get customers that either A, want to talk your ear off while you're trying to work, mm-hmm. or they like to try and touch stuff while you're working on it, which still blows my mind to this day. so we have it closed off in the back. We have one little doorway that leads into the back, and somehow customers still wander back there, but we try to keep them away from there as much as possible. As far as our mobile goes, we go to their door, we knock, you know, hey, how are you doing? This is what we're doing. We do our checklist right in front of them. And then we bring the device to the van and do the work in the van, and then bring it back out to them, do the checklist right in front of them.
Nice. Nice. Cool. Javi, how about you guys? I saw
you
shaking your head when I first asked.
We're pretty similar to Jonathan's. You know, we do like our main lab where we do like our iPhone repairs or screen replacements. That one has a window that you could see through from the retail room. We do have it vinyled, so it kind of, you know, it's kind of hard for them to look through unless they're up close on it. But they do have some transparency to look in there and see. And then we do have another area in the back, which is our laminating room, where we do all our refurbishing, which is totally closed off because, you know, we just it's the way our layout is. It's just, you know, we have separate rooms and that's just in the back there. So, but overall, I mean, I'd say, yeah, having a closed area is ideal, especially when we're here doing those intricate glass replacements. You know, if we're getting distracted talking, one wrong move, you know, we're going to lose an OLED panel and incur more costs. So I'm all for having it closed off and separated.
I agree 100%. My stores, we tried to separate it off. We did our design concept was kind of like a restaurant pass. Now keep in mind, not modern restaurant with an open kitchen, but kind of old diner style that had a little window. And we pass repairs back there. And most of the time we're able to be not distracted by customers, but it would be a little bit troublesome. So cool. Thanks for input there, guys. So let's take a look at some of these concepts, and we're gonna go through each of you guys' stuff right now. And I pulled some of this from, your websites or videos that you guys have out there. But let's start off with Javi's stuff, because I'll be honest with you. You know, I got this idea from watching your video, Javi. I saw you down at the show last week. It was really impressive the way you show off your shop. And I think this is a really good idea for anybody, quite frankly. And if you're not good on camera, Javi's very good on camera.
I try to be.
Very dynamic, try to be. Right? I know. And he's got great videos again on it. Check out his YouTube channel. But you know, if you're not great on video, that's cool. Get somebody else to do it. Hire somebody or a friend, you know, that's good at that kind of thing. Because you could put this on your website or put it on your Facebook page and let people know what to expect, right? I've even seen people do that with mobile repair. Have a setup, say, hey, here's what to expect, and kind of play act it, right? Have somebody walk up to your mom's house or something like that, and show how that kind of work works. So let's take a look at Javi's concept. We'll just take a quick look at the video here and kind of jump out of it, depending on time-wise here. I'm gonna look at my clock in a second, but let's take a look at this.
Hey, what's up, guys? I'm Javi Guzman with MrPhoneDoctor.com. Welcome to another video. And today, I'm gonna give you guys a behind the scenes of our headquarters. Follow me. Guys, so this is our retail lobby area. This is where customers come in. We assist all our customers by checking them in. We do offer a plethora of accessories as well, from cables, chargers, phones. If customers do need devices, we got plenty of phones available for sale. And this is pretty much our lobby area where customers hang out, and wait for their phone repairs or drop off and pick up. All right, so next I'm gonna go and show you guys our shipping department where we actually receive all our phones. So in this room here, this is where Fabian works. He's actually in charge of receiving all devices. He'll do a pre-test on them and post-test, make sure everything's working before and after repairs. So any type of mail-in incoming phones, we'll put them in here, check them in on our system. You guys will get an email once they arrive. Pretty much that wraps up our shipping department. Let's go ahead and roll into our lab number one, which is pretty much our disassembly area. This is where once the phones are checked in, we'll put our phones in queue right here. As you can see, this is the workload that we have right now. So I do apologize, you guys, for any delays. We've just been overwhelmed. We've been getting a lot of walk-ins and mail-ins at the same time. So thank you guys for your patience. Right here is our station number one. You can see where we have our heating plates, and we have Reeves over here working on a Galaxy S10. He's getting this out for a customer of ours. And over here, we actually have all our inventory. This is where we keep all our parts and our screens. So you can see how we like to keep everything nicely organized. Thankfully, we've all been able to collaborate together and come up with a system to help everything work in place and keep everything running fluid. We have all our small parts here, our screens over here, and we have a ton of these skeleton bones just everywhere. I don't think we're ever gonna get rid of these. They're Samsung frames, but yeah. But they're good to have, you know. We don't really throw anything away. I like to hoard stuff and keep them. You never know when things come in handy again. And if you follow me back over here, this is gonna be our lab two. This is our laminating station and of course our laser room. We have our station right here, which is our laminating. We have Sol here who is working on S10. So we're pretty much laminating an S10 in frame. We didn't take the phone apart. You can see that everything's still fully intact. We do have our deep freezer here, which is our deep freeze machine for Samsung Galaxy S8, S8 Pluses. So this is our M triangle machine. This is the laser machine that of preference of choice that we use on a frequent, you know. I just like the way it works. It gives it a nice clean finish. Forward's a really great machine as well. You know, thank you guys. I appreciate you guys for sponsoring us with the video. I'll leave a link if you guys do want to see this video in action. I did an in-depth tutorial and setup on this guy, which was great. You know, did a really clean job. So if you guys are in a pinch and want to save a little bit, go with Forward. It's a great machine as well. All right, guys. So that pretty much wraps up our lab two, laminating laser room.
All right. So that's going to wrap it up on the video there. Javi, nice job, man.
Thank you.
Yeah. I got to know about those fume extractors. I assume that's what those are off the ceiling.
Yes. Yeah. Those are actually fume extractors. We actually put those in after getting our laser machine because with the laser, they emit a lot of smoke. And then of course, with some of the solvents and stuff that we're using, you know, just for health purposes, we want to get all that stuff out. But it's crazy because now they make little fume extractors that are portable. You can just lay them over that laser machine and they got like built-in filtration. So the technology has just come along since all these devices have been coming out.
Yeah, but important to have in a shop for sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There's more to that video, which you guys could see on YouTube if you want to, but I think that kind of hit on the highlights there. So like I said, I would recommend to anybody with a repair business to produce a video of some kind, even if it's, a TikTok or whatever, just so customers can get familiar with how your operation is set up and know what to do when they come in. So now we're going to jump over to Scott's shop. And let me just tell you, when I first fell on to Scott's shop, Skinny's, I was like, wait, he does repair? Okay. I was like, I love the retail concept. And, you know, again, it, you know,
hey, thanks.
Different folks. But I just love the concept. And I guess, is this all your family here, Scott?
Family and employees. So to my right, my wife, holding my oldest boy, and then my brother to my left, he's actually kind of the one responsible for our look. He's our brand manager. Because I didn't really have the eye for it. You know, I knew I was good at running a business. But I wasn't good at making it look the way I wanted it to. He kind of came in and just ran with it. And then everyone else, employees to the left and right. Yeah.
Cool. So I pulled some of your pictures. So I want you to kind of walk us through those.
Okay.
I'm certain the one on the right is the before picture.
Yeah.
So tell us about these.
So these are actually two different shops. And I'm sorry, I didn't send you pictures. I appreciate you pulling them offline.
No worries.
the one on the right, so I've been doing phone repair out of the back of my car for about 6 months, and in Starbucks and HEB parking lots and all that. And so that was our first location, which we're still in Stephenville. It's just expanded and looks a lot nicer. The one on the left, yeah, that's our Waco location. We take up the bottom like half of that building, and it's beautiful. It's a really, really cool building. Both of them are downtown. We're in downtown Waco, in just like an 1800s building.
Nice. Yeah, I love that, and I love the opportunity that I think a lot of repair people have to get into these old buildings, right?
Yeah.
Were built hundreds or 100 years ago, and help revitalize their downtowns. Because I really think that, the repair business plays a really key part in community development. But let's take a few more looks here. So this is the inside of you guys' shops, I guess. Tell us a little bit about what we're seeing here.
So top right corner, where there's just Kinsey sitting there. That's our retail space and the store I'm at right now, Stephenville. That's our main hub. That's where we started. So that little picture you saw of me pointing, to coming soon, like that's that little sliver. And we just kind of started off in there and then expanded, got the area next door. And, we have a huge repair area. As you can see, it's just like kind of a cool little hole in the wall. It's got character. It's still left unfinished. It's just got that, kind of cool industrial look we've kind of run with.
Yeah, I like that.
Thank you. Far left, top left, that's our Waco spot. It's our open concept one. So we've got a big, huge front desk, and then our work tables in the back, are behind just a big area. But both have the same feel. We want them to, we want all of our stores to have the same feel, same natural look, same industrial look. We kind of just make everyone feel at home, like, I want to spend money here. I'm not worried about my information. I'm not worried about anything. I can trust these people. So we try to portray that in how we come across, just like everyone does, just like all the guys here do.
Yeah. No. I'm going to show you guys a store later too, that I was talking to them about polished look, I guess we could call it, to their stores, and they sell a lot more. They sell a lot more high-end items that way. So, you always got to keep that in consideration as you're designing your store. So here's another shot. I love the way you lay out the accessories. I used to do something similar. I'm assuming that display wall on the right hand, is that handmade? Somebody made that, or you guys made it?
Man, that's my brother. So everything you see, he's built. He spent about 15 years in the remodel and cabinet industry. When I hired him, he came with the with the mind, with the look, and also the skills. So yeah, he everything you see, he drew up, built. Top left, that's where I'm sitting right now. That's our main big back room in the Stephenville shop. Nice open, five or six people, we all work back here. The two main tables are where we do our phone repairs. The spot with the two monitors, that's our computer section. And then that's the bottom right's our Waco shop. But yeah, we tried with our Waco store to get away from pegboard and just kind of have a cool little layout for it. It's good and bad. It's good. It looks amazing. It's harder for organization, but it's I don't know. It's kind of a really it's a good talking point for customers when they come in. They really like it.
Yeah. I bet it generates a lot of discussion, I would imagine.
Yeah.
I'm somebody personally who hates slat wall. Pegboard or anything like that. I know some of you guys do it, and that's cool. But just me personally, I was very anti. So I went with a similar concept. Just didn't have a brother. In fact, I don't have a brother who does that. So can people hire him, by the way? I mean, if they're interested.
I mean, for the right price, I guess. Cool. He's done some work, but yeah.
Yeah. I like the repurposing. Also, do you guys just do that in one of your stores where you have kind of your parts in an old cabinet?
We have two of those that we picked up, just apothecary cabinets. One in our Decatur store, which is like a franchise that we run, and then our Waco store. And then Stephenville, we have a big built-in one that we made. It's really cool too. It's even got like a library ladder. We tend to go over the top. It's kind of ridiculous. But we have
fun. I love it. I mean, it's a much different concept.
Thanks.
I think it's going to generate a lot of discussion and a lot of people remember you. It's rememberable.
Yeah, thank you. That word.
Yeah, I love it. Absolutely. Well, thank you, Scott, first of all, and I'm glad we got to share those picks. Let's check out Jonathon's shop now, his main store here, iTech Shark, and, you know, get an idea. And we haven't revealed yet. I forget if it's the next one. I think the next one's the video. So let's take a look at the video. Yep, it's the video. And then we can talk about it a little bit after we see that.
Hey, guys, this is Colin with buyback.ai. Just showing you our demo location here in Baldwin, Missouri. One of the great things about this location, we've been in for about a year now, is the drive-through. COVID going on and everything else in the world. Our customers have utilized that heavily, and we've seen a great return on investment on putting that in the store. And I'm gonna go ahead and walk you guys into our showroom floor. You can see we have the newest IMAX to make the store look as good as possible, along with this amazing soundproof wall, which was definitely worth the investment. Once this door is closed, you can not hear anything. On the other side, it's great. Gives our customers some transparency, seeing the repairs get performed, which is where most of the repairs will be performed on this side of the store. As we make our way back to the buyback processing area. This is where we handle most of the inbound shipments, all the new products coming in every day. And over here, you can see what's our shipping area. And this is our lockup room. Got a heavy steel door, make sure it would take someone some serious time to get in here. So we keep all of our inventory. And this is going to be one of the coolest features of the store. I know, it's just a toilet, but does your toilet have a remote?
So I love, you know, when I was first watching that, I was like, oh my gosh, why is he going in the bathroom? But I was like, that's kind of cool, a remote for your toilet, I guess. I don't know.
It's got a seat warmer and a bidet.
Yeah.
Oh, a seat warmer,
it blow dries too.
Bougie.
Now, do you guys repair those too in case they break? Or
no, we don't touch
those. They don't touch that.
Are you able to do repairs while you're on there?
Maybe.
Yeah. No,
haven't caught anybody do that yet.
You know, now that I think about it, everybody may think that was the big reveal. You know, that I was talking about before about your shop, but the big reveal was the drive-through. I absolutely love the drive-through. You know, with your shop, these are the two big things, which again, I just absolutely love the drive-through and then the soundproof glass wall, you know, that we talked about earlier. But tell us a little bit about the drive-through, Jonathon.
Yeah. So, you know, it really depends how your store is set up, but if you could do a drive-through, it's really not that expensive. You're talking $1,200 for the pre-made drive-through window. And then about another $1,000 to hire somebody to put a hole in there and install it. So, you know, it's very low cost if your store is set up for the drive-through. So I would definitely recommend it. Ever since we put it in, customers they love it. Like they see it and they go up to the window and they usually make a quick joke, like they're ordering food or something. but you know, at almost all times of the day, there's just constant flow of cars that go through and use it. And especially the people that just want to drop off real quick, they'll just come drop it off and then come back later and come through the drive-through. But yeah, we see almost, I would say almost 50% or more of the customers utilize the drive-through.
Nice. Yeah. I love that. And you know, guys, everybody who's listening to this, you know, customers want convenience. You know, COVID kind of accelerated that a bit, I think. You know, I know a lot of people do curbside service, but this drive-through is brilliant on many levels, you know, for the COVID side of it, but also for just the convenience aspect of it. being able to drop something off and be able to pick it back up, you know, without getting out of your car. People want that. So keep that in mind as you're developing your stores. I know that's tough for retail. Look at old bank buildings. I tried to negotiate a lease for an old bank building one time. Unfortunately, the bank outbid me. You know, it's an opportunity you can find. And I think commercial real estate owners are open to that. Was the owner of the property, Jonathon, open to the idea?
So we actually own our own store here.
Well, then you were, yeah.
So, but I do know other people that have put in drive-throughs. If the store location is set up for it, usually yeah. they'll say yes.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what I've seen in this industry and just in retail, when you see something else, so, you know, keep bookmark Jonathon's store's page, you know, because they have that info on there. You know, you could tell the landlord, you know, hey, somebody else is doing it and he's really successful. So, you know, help us out. But cool idea. And again, there's that glass wall, which I just love. You know, what you're doing there with your shop. So really, really nice, Jonathon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Cool. Well, let's talk about CellMedic. I really wanted to show off the van and these are the only pictures I had.
Looking at a mess there.
Gotta show, you know, your design in there. So with the, you know, shelf in the back, the table. And this is something newer for you, right, Joseph?
Yeah, we actually just got the van done being wrapped about a week ago. Okay. We've had a handful of mobile repairs in it, but yeah, within the last 2 weeks, I'd say it's just a 2018 Ford Transit 250. Okay. It's a standard top. It's not a high top or a mid top. So,
right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a great setup. You got enough space in there for sure. You know, to do, repairs, you know, with a little repair desk over there. And then, you know, I assume you're using that, parts bin. For your supplies and things, yeah?
Yeah, so basically we triple purpose this van. It's for mobile repairs. It's obviously a giant driving advertisement. Then we also use it for transportation of devices between the two stores.
Nice.
So that black Husky toolbox you're looking at holds any of our tools, holds any of our parts and accessories, or any of our parts. And then obviously the repair table. And then the gray shelving unit you see on the side holds the bins for any of the devices we're transporting. If the customer wants us to do a computer repair or something like that, where it's just not feasible on site, we'll still go pick it up from them and transport it back to the store and then drop it off to them.
Nice.
That's kind of what the shelving gets used for.
Nice. Yeah. 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 Well, I would expect that business would expand for you. Just cause, you know, I think mobile repair is something that is becoming more and more important. You know, again, convenience. People want convenience, and to have somebody come to you, or at least to pick up and drop off, is very valuable. Any other highlights, you know, you want to hit on either about your store? I don't have pictures of your store, but
I sent you a couple of those. As far as the van goes, not really. The only other thing we're working on right now is I've got an enclosed trailer that we're working on getting wrapped that will have the grid wall H units inside the trailer.
Nice.
So that when we go to events, we can just pop out accessories and basically have a complete mobile shop as we go.
That's great. Yeah, that's a great idea. And I think events are something that's a great opportunity for anybody, you know, or being able to find where you can. In fact, I've always promoted kind of a food truck kind of idea. You know, I mean, imagine if you could pull up a repair shop right out in front of the Apple store, right? You know, I know there's permitting and stuff like that you got to do, but I think that's a tremendous opportunity is having kind of a mobile store kind of setup where you can sell accessories as well.
Exactly.
Good job there, Joseph. Looking good, man. All right. I'm going to jump over to Juan and tell you what, we're going to go through the pictures you sent me, that I have. So, you know, when I first saw this picture, I was like going, okay, nice repair desk. You know, it's organized. But then I realized as I kind of zoomed out on it, that's a little mobile setup that Juan has. So tell us a little bit about it, you know, while you drive, Juan. Be safe. Don't be dangerous. I know you're trying to make some money here, but tell us.
Yeah, so like I said, I had an office before, but I ended up switching just to mobile. Due to COVID, I'm in Southern California. So even right now, not everything is 100% open. And there's still some stores that are not open for repair. So obviously that has benefited us. So we have just completely went straight to just mobile. So I used to do it up front, but you know, with mobile, The thing is, mobile repair gets a bad reputation because they always think you're going to steal their device, or you don't offer any warranty, or you're just not going to do a good job. So I had to be creative and find out, you know, what is going to set me apart and what's going to make me look professional, besides having my logo on my car and on a shirt and on a hat and even people filling out warranty. What's going to be the way to separate myself from everyone else? And I found out this setup was honestly, you know, if you look close enough, you're not going to think it's from a car.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah, when I first saw it, I was pretty impressed with the way you designed that.
This setup, actually, I just changed it this morning, just because. Oh, nice. So as it is for repairs, because I work by appointment, but however someone calls, I'm going to go. I carry basically any part from an iPhone 6 to the 12 Pro Max. So just carrying all those screens and iPad screens, just it was getting a bit difficult the way that I was doing it.
Cool. I'm gonna jump out of my screen share just so we can have a better shot of what you're doing, Juan. So get that camera going, friend, and we are gonna boom pop out here so you guys
see. Okay.
On a little bit better.
Having that set up out there. So basically, this is our new setup. How we have it.
Oh, nice. Nice.
So I ended up, this is the time we usually use when we do the pop-up events and all that. So basically, you just come over here, sit down, have all your screens, you know, for iPads, Protection Pro, heat gun, and everything else.
Wow. You've got a really nice setup there. I mean, the Protection Pro is the customizable screens, correct?
Yeah. So honestly, Protection Pro, we've had it for a few months. Going on our actual second month, but it's the top seller. Even we have folks booked just for Protection Pro, so we'll go over and set it up.
Cool. So do you have people that can order just a screen protector, and you'll come over and do that?
Yeah, through our booking system, we have everything is pretty easy. For the most part, we don't usually work on call because everyone would typically book their appointments ahead of time.
Right.
So with that, folks can just book. If they want their privacy screen, we have it. We have a bunch of skins and all that. So folks can book that. They can obviously book their iPads or do it. Samsung's, iPhones. And then we carry, like I said, a bunch of everything. And I even have more accessories just because you want to take advantage. I'm mobile and I do have someone help me out, but their setup, I'm still making it. But for the most part, you want to have everything at your disposal. And if you go, anyone who's mobile knows this. Someone says it's an iPhone 11, you go there, it's an 11 Pro. Or they say it's a 6, it's a 6S. So by having all the tools at my disposal, no matter what the repair, I can always be able to fix the phone.
Nice, nice. Well, I love it. That's a great setup. And I mean, you know, best of luck to you overall. You know, I think mobile repair is an important part of the industry. And is only going to grow and expand. And the more you can do, like with screen protectors and things like that, I think is awesome. I really do. So thanks for sharing that with us, Juan. We got a few more things to look at. I want to show you guys this, a repair shop outside. This is a Mobile Outfitters location. And if you check it out, it's on the beach. So this is a nice concept. And I'll tell you, touristy locations are great locations. So any of y'all that are expanding or getting into something like that, you know, where tourists are, I mean, they're desperate, right? Because, they're usually their only option when they're traveling is, you know, to wait till they get home. So, you know, they're more than willing to pay for a repair. So this is a pretty neat kind of small kiosk operation with Mobile Outfitters that's outside. So here we have a repair shop that has a pool table in it, okay? This is a company called Fixology. They were going to join us today, but had some things going on. So their idea with their shop is just a really super chill space where people feel really comfortable. They can come in, I guess, shoot a game of pool, while they're getting their phone fixed and, you know, pick up some accessories at the same time. Source One Phones, fancy, fancy, fancy. I love what these guys do. They also have a family member like Scott who helps design their stores. And you can check out real quick. And let me tell you, this is what I was talking about when I say that they make a lot of money on accessories and devices. customers coming into the store feel really comfortable. I talked to one of their managers there who told me he's worked at a couple of chain stores, a couple of big guys. He said he's never worked at a store that sold this many devices overall. And you can see there, you know, I love the word art on the wall there. I think that's always nice as well. And a really clean layout and really professional look overall. What do you guys think about, you know, a fancier store, someplace that's, you know, kind of like fine dining? Jonathon, you got any thoughts on that?
I've always thought a very well designed, high tech or fancy, expensive store works out better. It builds trust. Your customer instantly walks in and they somehow just kind of trust you, which we found. I agree. I like the fancy locations.
Nice. Scott, you guys kind of fall into that category, although you're kind of, I don't know, I'd say fancy / retro. So yeah. So what are your thoughts on these?
Man, same, you know, and, you know, we had a guy try to move into our Stephenville town and kind of throwing a little hole in the wall, and you know, we were significantly more expensive. I mean, we were across the board 20 to 30 to 50 bucks higher per repair, and he lasted a year, then took off.
Wow.
So I mean, really, it's just if you put your best foot forward, you have a little more freedom there. I mean, we offer, you know, better warranties than some do, but you know, really, like, you know, like y'all said, I mean, it's creating that trust, and it's them walking in and saying, okay, like, I'm going to come here. I'm going to recommend all my family to come here, because I don't think I'm going to, you know, get taken advantage of. So yeah, I'm a strong supporter of that as well. Yeah.
Yeah. I think everybody has in common, you know, that professional look to it. And I'll tell you, at the Tech Care Association, that's what we want to promote and help to do better. Really, that's one of our main goals, is helping people do better. But you know, these professional looks that you guys all have, you know, to your operations is a really important part of it. And I think, you know, it's just different degrees then, you know, depending on your type of location and whether or not, you know, you want to invest more in, you know, a cleaner, higher end type look that might help you sell more accessories, more product, you know, or if you're, you know, doing really well with repair, you know, you may not have to go that way. So, you know, definitely an option. And these are, here's an idea I love that anybody can do in their shop. And that's a little cooler and or coffee machine. You know, this is a great little side item there. It looks like they have cupcakes. Must be pre-COVID when they had those out. You know, but that's something you can do in your store. Some people I know even get Coke machines, you know, the little small ones and things like that. But things that can make your customers feel at home, feel more comfortable, you know, again, nice option there. So what about the back of the shop? Well, let me really quickly, because we're getting close to our end here, and I like to end on time. I want to introduce you guys to Uline, if you don't know about Uline. We don't have any deals with them yet, working on it. But, you know, for setup in the back of your shop, I know a lot of guys build their own stuff, and that's great. But let me give you something simple, easy, okay? A couple of things for your shops. And that is, number one, organize your parts, okay? So I used to go with the shelves on the left-hand side. In fact, you can see them on the middle and right-hand side. You know, real easy to label, real easy to stock, steel shelf, very, you know, solid. You even get kind of a mini unit. They pop out. See how the parts pop out on the left-hand side picture. But you can pick those up and get bins for them too, either plastic or cardboard, that make organizing your parts. And you really want to be organized. We saw that in some of the shops today, and you guys are doing a great job of that. I love what Scott's doing with the, you know, the repurposing. You know, of materials, you know, to be able to do that. And, you know, I'd love to see some more concepts like that, where people are repurposing things for, you know, utilization within their store. And then the last thing is organizing the devices you fix. You know, when you're first starting off, you're going to be tempted just to, you know, grab a phone, carry it to the back, you know, and work on it. Our check-in process within our stores used to always require we bin everything. And, you know, a lot of reasons for that. Sometimes it's a really simple repair, but sometimes it gets complicated and you've got to have all the parts together. So a bin was always a really easy way to do that. We actually, and I won't go into it this webinar, but we color coded our bins depending on the type of repair work they were getting so that we could see them. in the shop and know what was going on if we saw something sitting around. You guys have something real quick, we're running low on time, but something real quick on organization, either shelving or devices.
One thing that we just recently started using, Injured Gadget sells little bins that have plenty of room for like the note devices, which is something we were running into issues with. When you open the top half of the box, there's a section where you can lay the motherboard or small parts, stuff like that. There's another small section where you can lay the screws in that's actually numbered. They're only like, I think $3, maybe $4. And then we take little stickers and put them on the side and just label them as like Enviro VP 1 through 40. And then it allows us to enter that into our POS system. It works really well.
Nice, nice. Yeah, software is something we'll talk about another day, but yeah, that organizational system, we also use the labeled stuff we worked on as well. So cool. Again, we're running low on time, so I don't want to drag this out. I like to end on time, so I'm valuing everybody's time. Our panelists, you guys are awesome. I appreciate it. Thank you very much. We're going to do our prize drawings this week, which are all from the Tech Care Association. I'll do those randomly from everybody who was on the webinar. So I'll pull those names and contact them. We've had some trouble in the past, so I want to make sure I'm accurate with that. But we're giving away these things. You can find the t-shirt on our website if you want to buy one. Members get $10 off, so it's a great way, a great reason to join us as well. So as we close here, I want to thank for participating in the webinar. We've got one coming up on September 23rd. Thank you, guys. I appreciate you being on our panel today. Thank you so much, and have a great day, a successful day.
Thanks, Rob. Good meeting you guys.
Have a great day.
Have a good day.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see.